Airbus A300. The Airbus A300 is a widebody twin-engine jet airliner developed and manufactured by Airbus. Formally announced in 1969 and first flying in October 1972, it holds the distinction of being the world's first twin-engined widebody airliner. It was also the first product of Airbus Industrie, a consortium of European aerospace manufacturers, now known as Airbus. The A300 can typically seat 266 passengers in a two-class layout, with a maximum range of when fully loaded, depending on model. Development of the A300 began during the 1960s as a European collaborative project between various aircraft manufacturers in the United Kingdom, France, and West Germany. In September 1967, the participating nations signed a Memorandum of Understanding to manufacture the aircraft. The British withdrew from the project on April 10, 1969. A new agreement was reached between Germany and France on May 29, 1969, and Airbus Industrie was formally created on December 18, 1970 to develop and produce the A300. The type first flew on October 28, 1972. Air France, the launch customer for the A300, introduced the type into service on May 30, 1974. Following a period of limited customer demand, the A300 achieved several large sales in 1978, after which the type was viewed to have proven itself and orders came in at a steady rate across the next three decades. During the 1990s, the A300 became popular with various freight operators, and several different cargo aircraft variants were produced. Production of the A300 ceased in July 2007, along with its smaller A310 derivative. The freighter sales for which the A300 had previously competed in later life are instead fulfilled by the A330-200F, a derivative of the newer Airbus A330. During the 1960s, European aircraft manufacturers such as Hawker Siddeley and the British Aircraft Corporation, based in the UK, and Sud Aviation of France, had ambitions to build a new 200-seat airliner for the growing civil aviation market. While studies were performed and considered, such as a stretched twin engine of the Hawker Siddeley Trident and an expanded development of the British Aircraft Corporation BAC-111 designated the BAC-211, it was recognized that if each of the European manufacturers were to launch quite similar aircraft onto the market at the same time, none of them would achieve the volume sales needed to make them viable. In 1965, a British government study, known as the Plowden Report, had found British aircraft production costs to be between 10 and 20% higher than American counterparts due to shorter production runs, which in turn was due to the fractured European market. To overcome this factor, the report recommended the pursuit of multinational collaborative projects between the region's leading aircraft manufacturers. European manufacturers were keen to explore prospective programs. The proposed 260-seat widebody HBN-100 between Hawker Siddeley, Nor Aviation, and Brigitte Aviation being one such example. National governments were also keen to support such efforts amid a belief that American manufacturers could dominate the European economic community. In particular, Germany had ambitions for a multinational airliner project to invigorate its aircraft industry, which had declined considerably following the Second World War. During the mid-1960s, both Air France and American Airlines had expressed interest in a short-haul twin-engine wide-body aircraft, indicating a market demand for such an aircraft to be produced. In July 1967, during a high-profile meeting between French, German, and British ministers, an agreement was made for greater cooperation between European nations in the field of aviation technology, and for the joint development and production of an Airbus. The word Airbus at this point was a generic aviation term for a larger commercial aircraft, and was considered acceptable in multiple languages, including French. Shortly after the July 1967 meeting, French engineer Roger Bitet was appointed as the technical director of what would become the A300 program, while Henri Ziegler, chief operating officer of Sud Aviation, was appointed as the general manager of the organization, and German politician Franz Josef Strauss became the chairman of the supervisory board. Bitet drew up an initial work share plan for the project, under which French firms would produce the aircraft's cockpit, the control systems, and lower center portion of the fuselage. Hawker Siddeley would manufacture the wings, while German companies would produce the forward, rear and upper part of the center fuselage sections. Addition work included moving elements of the wings being produced in the Netherlands, and Spain producing the horizontal tailplane. An early design goal for the A300 that Bitet had stressed the importance of was the incorporation of a high level of technology, which would serve as a decisive advantage over prospective competitors. As such, the A300 would feature the first use of composite materials of any passenger aircraft, the leading and trailing edges of the tail fin being composed of glass fiber reinforced plastic. BTA opted for English as the working language for the developing aircraft, as well against using metric instrumentation and measurements, as most airlines already had US-built aircraft. These decisions were partially influenced by feedback from various airlines, such as Air France and Lufthansa, as an emphasis had been placed on determining specifics of what kind of aircraft that potential operators were seeking. According to Airbus, this cultural approach to market research had been crucial to the company's long-term success. On September 26, 1967, the British, French, and West German governments signed a Memorandum of Understanding to start development of the 300-seat Airbus A300. At this point, the A300 was only the second major joint aircraft program in Europe, the first being the Anglo-French Concorde. Under the terms of the memorandum, Britain and France were each to receive a 37.5% work share on the project, while Germany received a 25% share. Sud Aviation was recognized as the lead company for A300, with Hawker Siddeley being selected as the British partner company. At the time, the news of the announcement had been clouded by the British government's support for the Airbus, which coincided with its refusal to back BAC's proposed competitor, the BAC 211, despite a preference for the latter expressed by British European Airways, BEA. Another parameter was the requirement for a new engine to be developed by Rolls-Royce to power the proposed airliner, a derivative of the in-development Rolls-Royce RB211, the triple-spool RB207, capable of producing a 47,500 lbf. In December 1968, the French and British partner companies, Sud Aviation and Hawker Siddeley, proposed a revised configuration, the 250-seat Airbus A250. It had been feared that the original 300-seat proposal was too large for the market, thus it had been scaled down to produce the A250. The dimensional changes involved in the shrink reduced the length of the fuselage by 5.62 meters and the diameter by 0.8 meters, reducing the overall weight by 25 tons. For increased flexibility, the cabin floor was raised so that standard LD3 freight containers could be accommodated side by side, allowing more cargo to be carried. Refinements made by Hawker Siddeley to the wing's design provided for greater lift and overall performance. This gave the aircraft the ability to climb faster and attain a level cruising altitude sooner than any other passenger aircraft. It was later renamed the A300B. Perhaps the most significant change of the A300B was that it would not require new engines to be developed, being of a suitable size to be powered by Rolls-Royce SRB211, or alternatively the American Pratt & Whitney JT90 and General Electric CF6 power plants. This switch was recognized as considerably reducing the project's development costs. To attract potential customers in the U.S. market, it was decided that General Electric CF650 engines would power the A300 in place of the British RB207. These engines would be produced in cooperation with French firm Snecma. By this time, Rolls-Royce had been concentrating their efforts upon developing their RB211 turbofan engine instead, and progress on the RB207's development had been slow for some time, the firm having suffered due to funding limitations, both of which had been factors in the engine switch decision. On April 10, 1969, a few months after the decision to drop the RB207 had been announced, the British government announced that they would withdraw from the Airbus venture. In response, West Germany proposed to France that they would be willing to contribute up to 50% of the project's costs if France was prepared to do the same. Additionally, the managing director of Hawker Siddeley, Sir Arnold Alexander Hall, decided that his company would remain in the project as a favored subcontractor, developing and manufacturing the wings for the A300, which would later become pivotal in later versions' impressive performance from short domestic to long intercontinental flights. Hawker Siddeley spent £35 million of its own funds, along with a further £35 million loan from the West German government, on the machine tooling to design and produce the wings. On May 29, 1969, during the Paris Air Show, French Transport Minister Jean Chamont and German Economics Minister Karl Schiller signed an agreement officially launching the Airbus A300, the world's first twin-engine wide-body airliner. The intention of the project was to produce an aircraft that was smaller, lighter, and more economical than its three-engine American rivals, the McDonnell Douglas DC-10 and the Lockheed L-1011 TriStar. In order to meet Air France's demands for an aircraft larger than 250-seat A300B, it was decided to stretch the fuselage to create a new variant, designated as the A300B2, which would be offered alongside the original 250-seat A300B, henceforth referred to as the A300B1. On September 3, 1970, Air France signed a letter of intent for six A300s, marking the first order to be won for the new airliner. In the aftermath of the Paris Air Show agreement, it was decided that, in order to provide effective management of responsibilities, a groupement inter-economic would be established, allowing the various partners to work together on the project while remaining separate business entities. On December 18, 1970, Airbus Industrie was formally established following an agreement between Aerospatiale, the newly merged SAT Aviation and Nor Aviation of France, and the antecedents to Deutsche Aerospace of Germany, each receiving a 50% stake in the newly formed company. In 1971, the consortium was joined by a third full partner, the Spanish firm CASA, who received a 4.2% stake, the other two members reducing their stakes to 47.9% each. In 1979, Britain joined the Airbus consortium via British Aerospace, which Hawkers Italy had merged into, which acquired a 20% stake in Airbus Industrie, with France and Germany each reducing their stakes to 37.9%. Airbus Industrie was initially headquartered in Paris, which is where design, development, flight testing, sales, marketing, and customer support activities were centered. The headquarters was relocated to Toulouse in January 1974. The final assembly line for the A300 was located adjacent to Toulouse-Blagnac International Airport. The manufacturing process necessitated transporting each aircraft section being produced by the partner companies scattered across Europe to this one location. The combined use of ferries and roads were used for the assembly of the first A300, however this was time-consuming and not viewed as ideal by Felix Kracht, Airbus Industrie's production director. Kracht's solution was to have the various A300 sections brought to Toulouse by a fleet of Boeing 777-derived Aerospaceline Super Guppy aircraft, by which means none of the manufacturing sites were more than 2 hours away. Having the sections airlifted in this manner made the A300 the first airliner to use just-in-time manufacturing techniques, and allowed each company to manufacture its sections as fully equipped, ready-to-fly assemblies. In September 1969, construction of the first prototype A300 began. On September 28, 1972, this first prototype was unveiled to the public. It conducted its maiden flight from Toulouse-Blagnac International Airport on 28 October that year. This maiden flight, which was performed a month ahead of schedule, lasted for 1 hour and 25 minutes. The captain was Max Fiskel and the first officer was Bernard Ziegler, son of Henri Ziegler. On February 5, 1973, the second prototype performed its maiden flight. The flight test program, which involved a total of 4 aircraft, was relatively problem-free, accumulating 1,580 flight hours throughout. In September 1973, as part of promotional efforts for the A300, the new aircraft was taken on a 6-week tour around North America and South America, to demonstrate it to airline executives, pilots, and would-be customers. Amongst the consequences of this expedition, it had allegedly brought the A300 to the attention of Frank Borman of Eastern Airlines, one of the big 4 U.S. airlines. On March 15, 1974, type certificates were granted for the A300 from both German and French authorities, clearing the way for its entry into revenue service. On May 23, 1974, Federal Aviation Administration, FAA, certification was received. The first production model, the A300B2, entered service in 1974, followed by the A300B4 1 year later. Initially, the success of the consortium was poor, in part due to the economic consequences of the 1973 oil crisis, but by 1979 there were 81 A300 passenger liners in service with 14 airlines, alongside 133 firm orders and 88 options. 10 years after the official launch of the A300, the company had achieved a 26% market share in terms of dollar value, enabling Airbus Industries to proceed with the development of its second aircraft, the Airbus A310. It was the launch of the Airbus A320 in 1987 that firmly established Airbus as a major player in the aircraft market, Over 400 orders were placed before the narrow-body airliner had flown its first flight, compared to 15 for the A300 in 1972. The Airbus A300 is a widebody medium to long-range airliner. It has the distinction of being the first twin-engine widebody aircraft in the world. In 1977, the A300 became the first ETOPS-compliant aircraft, due to its high performance and safety standards. Another world first of the A300 is the use of composite materials on a commercial aircraft, which was used on both secondary and later primary airframe structures, decreasing overall weight and improving cost effectiveness. Other firsts included the pioneering use of center of gravity control, achieved by transferring fuel between various locations across the aircraft, and electrically signaled secondary flight controls. The A300 is powered by a pair of underwing turbofan engines, either General Electric CF6 and Pratt & Whitney JT9D engines. The sole use of underwing engine pods allowed for any suitable turbofan engine to be more readily used. The lack of a third tail-mounted engine, as per the trijet configuration used by some competing airliners, allowed for the wings to be located further forwards and to reduce the size of the vertical stabilizer and elevator, which had the effect of increasing the aircraft's flight performance and fuel efficiency. Airbus partners had employed the latest technology, some of which having been derived from Concorde, on the A300. According to Airbus, new technologies adopted for the airliner were selected principally for increased safety, operational capability, and profitability. Upon entry into service in 1974, the A300 was a very advanced plane, which went on to influence later airliner designs. The technological highlights include: later A300s incorporated other advanced features such as the forward-facing crew cockpit, which enabled the two-pilot flight crew to fly the aircraft alone without the need for a flight engineer, the functions of which were automated. This two-man cockpit concept was a world first for a widebody aircraft. Glass cockpit flight instrumentation, which used cathode ray tube (CRT) monitors to display flight, navigation, and warning information, along with fully digital dual autopilots and digital flight control computers for controlling the spoilers, flaps, and leading edge slats, were also adopted up in later built models. Additional composites were also made use of, such as carbon fiber reinforced polymer, CFRP, as well as their presence in an increasing proportion of the aircraft's components, including the spoilers, rudder, air brakes, and landing gear doors. Another feature of later aircraft were the addition of wingtip fences, which generated greater aerodynamic performance, first introduced on the A310-300. In addition to passenger duties, the A300 became widely used by air freight operators. According to Airbus, it is the best-selling freight aircraft of all time. Various variants of the A300 were built to meet customer demands, often for diverse roles such as aerial refueling tankers, freighter models, new build and conversions, combi aircraft, military airlifter, and VIP transport. Perhaps the most visually unique of the variants is the A300-600ST Beluga, an oversized cargo-carrying model operated by Airbus to carry aircraft sections between their manufacturing facilities. The A300 was the basis for, and retained a high level of commonality with, the second airliner produced by Airbus, the smaller Airbus A310. On May 23, 1974, the first A300 to enter service performed the first commercial flight of the type, flying from Paris to London, for Air France. Immediately after the launch, sales of the A300 were weak for some years, with most orders going to airlines that had an obligation to favor the domestically made product, notably Air France and Lufthansa, the first two airlines to place orders for the type. Following the appointment of Bernard Lavier as Henri Ziegler's replacement, an aggressive sales approach was adopted. Indian Airlines was the world's first domestic airline to purchase the A300, ordering three aircraft with three options. However, between December 1975 and May 1977, there were no sales for the type. During this period, a number of whitetail A300s, completed but unsold aircraft, were completed and stored at Toulouse, and production fell to half an aircraft per month amid calls to pause production completely. During the flight testing of the A300B2, Airbus held a series of talks with Korean Air on the topic of developing a longer-range version of the A300, which would become the A300B4. In September 1974, Korean Air placed an order for four A300B4s with options for two further aircraft, This sale was viewed as significant as it was the first non-European international airline to order Airbus aircraft. Airbus had viewed Southeast Asia as a vital market that was ready to be opened up and believed Korean Air to be the key. It was becoming clear that the whole concept of a short-haul wide-body was flawed. Airlines operating the A300 on short-haul routes were forced to reduce frequencies to try and fill the aircraft. As a result, they lost passengers to airlines operating more frequent narrow-body flights. The supposed wide-body comfort which it was assumed passengers would demand was illusory. Eventually, Airbus had to build its own narrow-body aircraft, the A320, to compete with the Boeing 737 and McDonnell Douglas DC-9, MD-80. The savior of the A300 was the advent of extended-range twin operations, ETOPS, a revised FAA rule which allows twin engine jets to fly long-distance routes that were previously off-limits to them. This enabled Airbus to develop the aircraft as a medium-slash-long-range airliner. In 1977, U.S. carrier Eastern Airlines leased four A300s as an in-service trial. Frank Borman, ex-astronaut and the then-CEO of the airline, was impressed that the A300 consumed 30% less fuel, even more economical than expected, in contrast to his fleet of TriStars, and proceeded to order 23 A300s, becoming the first U.S. customer for the type. This order is often cited as the point at which Airbus came to be seen as a serious competitor to the large American aircraft manufacturers Boeing and McDonnell Douglas. Aviation author John Bowen alleged that various concessions, such as loan guarantees from European governments and compensation payments, were a factor in the decision as well. The Eastern Airlines breakthrough was shortly followed by an order from Pan Am. From then on, the A300 family sold well, eventually reaching a total of 816 delivered aircraft. In December 1977, Aerocondor Colombia became the first Airbus operator in Latin America, leasing one Airbus A300, named Ciudad de Barranquilla. During the late 1970s, Airbus adopted a so-called Silk Road strategy, targeting airlines in the Far East. As a result, the aircraft found particular favor with Asian airlines, being bought by Japan Air System, Korean Air, China Eastern Airlines, Thai Airways International, Singapore Airlines, Malaysia Airlines, Philippine Airlines, Garuda Indonesia, China Airlines, Pakistan International Airlines, Indian Airlines, Trans-Australia Airlines and many others. As Asia did not have restrictions similar to the FAA 60 minutes rule for twin-engine airliners which existed at the time, Asian Airlines used A300s for routes across the Bay of Bengal and South China Sea. In 1977, the A300B4 became the first ETOPS-compliant aircraft. Its high performance and safety standards qualified it for extended twin-engine operations over water, providing operators with more versatility in routing. In 1982, Garuda Indonesia became the first airline to fly the A300B4-200FF. By 1981, Airbus was growing rapidly, with over 300 aircraft sold and options for 200 more planes for over 40 airlines. Alarmed by the success of the A300, Boeing responded with the new Boeing 767. In 1989, Chinese operator China Eastern Airlines received its first A300. By 2006, the airline operated around 18 A300s, making it the largest operator of both A300 and the A310 at that time. On May 31, 2014, China Eastern officially retired the last A300-600 in its fleet, having begun drawing down the type in 2010. From 1997 to 2014, a single A300, designated A300-0G, was operated by the European Space Agency, ESA, Centre Nationale d'Études Spatiales, CNES, and the German Aerospace Center, DLR, as a reduced-gravity aircraft for conducting research into microgravity. The A300 is the largest aircraft to ever have been used in this capacity. A typical flight would last for 2.5 hours, enabling up to 30 parabolas to be performed per flight. By the 1990s, the A300 was being heavily promoted as a cargo freighter. The largest freight operator of the A300 is FedEx Express, which has 68 A300 aircraft in service. UPS Airlines also operates 52 freighter versions of the A300. The final version was the A300-600R and is rated for 180-minute ETOPS. The A300 has enjoyed renewed interest in the second-hand market for conversion to freighters. Large numbers were being converted during the late 1990s. The freighter versions, either new-build A300-600S or converted ex-passenger A300-600S, A300B2S and B4S, account for most of the world freighter fleet after the Boeing 747 freighter. The A300 provided Airbus the experience of manufacturing and selling airliners competitively. The basic fuselage of the A300 was later stretched, A330 onto 340, shortened, A310, or modified into derivatives, A300-600ST Beluga Supertransporter. In March 2006, Airbus announced the impending closure of A300/A310 final assembly line, making them the first Airbus aircraft to be discontinued. The final production A300, an A300F freighter, performed its initial flight on April 18, 2007, and was delivered to FedEx Express on July 12, 2007. Airbus has announced a support package to keep A300S flying commercially until at least 2025. The useful life of the UPS fleet of 52 delivered from 2000 to 2006 will be extended to 2035 by a flight deck upgrade based around Honeywell Primus Epic Avionics, new displays and flight management system, FMS, improved 3D weather radar, a central maintenance system, and a new version of the current enhanced ground proximity warning system. With a light usage of only 2 to 3 cycles per day, it will not reach the maximum number of cycles by then. The first modification will be made at Airbus Toulouse in 2019 and certified in 2020. As of July 2017, there are 211 A300s in service with 22 operators, with the largest operator being FedEx Express with 68 A300-600F aircraft. Only two were built, the first prototype, registered FWAB, then FOCUS, and a second aircraft, FWUAC, which was leased in November 1974 to Trans-European Airways, TEA, and re-registered UTEF. T instantly subleased the aircraft for 6 weeks to Air Algérie, but continued to operate the aircraft until 1990. It had accommodation for 300 passengers, TEA, or 323 passengers, Air Algérie, with a maximum weight of 132,000 kg and two General Electric CF650A engines off 220 kN thrust. The A300B1 was 5 frames shorter than the later production versions, being only 50.97 meters, 167.2 feet, in length. The first production version, powered by General Electric CF6 or Pratt & Whitney JT9D engines, the same engines that powered the Boeing 747-100, the original jumbo jet, of between 227 and 236 kN thrust, it entered service with Air France in May 1974. The prototype A300B2 made its first flight on 28 June 1973 and was certificated by the French and German authorities on March 15, 1974, and FAA approval followed on May 30, 1974. The first production A300B2, A300 No. 5, made its maiden flight on April 15, 1974 and was handed over to Air France a few weeks later on May 10, 1974. The A300B2 entered revenue service on May 23, 1974 between Paris and London. The major production version features a center fuel tank for increased fuel capacity, 47,500 kg, and new wing root Kruger flaps which were later made available as an option for the B2. Production of the B2 and B4 totaled 248. The first A300B4, the ninth A300, flew on December 25, 1974 and was certified on March 26, 1975. The first delivery was made to Bavaria German Air, which later merged into Hapag-Lloyd, on May 23, 1975. Officially designated A300B4-600, this version is nearly the same length as the B2 and B4 but has increased space because it uses the A310 rear fuselage and horizontal tail. It has higher power CF680 or Pratt & Whitney PW4000 engines and uses the Honeywell 331-250 Auxiliary Power Unit, APU. Other changes include an improved wing featuring a recambered trailing edge, the incorporation of simpler single-slotted Fowler flaps, the deletion of slat fences, and the removal of the outboard ailerons after they were deemed unnecessary on the A310. The A300-600 made its first flight on July 8, 1983 and entered service later that year with Saudi Arabian Airlines. A total of 313 A300-600s, all versions, have been sold. The A300-600 also has a similar cockpit to the A310, eliminating the need for a flight engineer. The FAA issues a single type rating which allows operation of both the A310 and A300-600. Introduced a shorter fuselage, a new, higher aspect ratio wing, smaller horizontal tail and two crew operation. It was available in standard -200 and the extended range -300 with range in both passenger and full cargo versions. It was also available as a military tanker/transport serving the Canadian Forces and German Air Force. Sales total 260, although five of these, ordered by Iraqi Airways, were never built. Commonly referred to as the Airbus Beluga or Airbus Supertransporter, these five airframes are used by Airbus to ferry parts between the company's disparate manufacturing facilities, thus enabling work-share distribution. They replaced the four aerospace lines Super Guppies previously used by Airbus. ICAO code, EST. As of September 2015, the A300 has been involved in 70 accidents and incidents, including 32 hull losses and 1,435 fatalities. Four A300s are currently preserved. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.